The Lord be with you.
With our spirit.
Let us pray.
Almighty God, whose blessed Son was led by the Spirit to be tempted by Satan, come quickly to help us who are assaulted by many temptations. And as you know the weakness of each of us, let each one find you mighty to save. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God now and forever. Amen. Now please be seated as we give our attention to the reading of Holy Scripture.
Reading from the book of Genesis. God said to Noah and his sons with them, "As for me, I'm establishing my covenant with you and your descendants after you, and every living creature that is with you, the birds, the domestic animals, and every animal of the earth with you, as many as came out of the ark. I establish my covenant with you, that never again shall flesh be cut off by waters of the flood, and never again there shall be a flood to destroy the earth." God said, "This is a sign of the covenant that I make between me and you and every living creature that is with you. For all future generations, I have set my bow in the clouds, and it shall be a sign of the covenant between me and the earth. When I bring the clouds over the earth, the bow is seen in the clouds. I remember my covenant that is between me, you, and every living creature of all flesh. And the waters shall never again become a flood to destroy all flesh. When the bow is in the clouds, I'll see it and remember the everlasting covenant between God and every living creature of all flesh that is on the earth." God said to Noah, "This is a sign of the covenant that I've established between me and all flesh that is on the earth." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Today we will be reading Psalm 25, responsibly by whole verse. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. My God, I put my trust in you. Let me not be humiliated, nor let my enemies triumph over me.
Let none who looks to you be put to shame. Let the treacherous be disappointed.
Show me your ways, O Lord, and teach me your paths.
Lead me in your truth and teach me, for you are the God of my salvation. In you I have trusted all the day long.
Remember, O Lord, your compassion and love, for they are from everlasting.
Remember not the sins of my youth and my transgressions. Remember me according to your love.
Gracious and upright is the Lord. Therefore, he teaches sinners in his way.
He guides the humble in doing right and teaches his way to the lowly.
All the paths of the Lord are love and faithfulness to those who keep his covenant and testimonies.
A reading from the first letter of Peter. Christ suffered for sins once for all, the righteous for the unrighteous, in order to bring you to God. He was put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the Spirit, in which he also went and made a proclamation to the spirits in prison, who in former times did not obey, when God waited patiently in the days of Noah during the building of the ark, in which a few, that is, eight persons, were saved through water. And baptism, which this prefigured, now saves you. Not as a removal of dirt from the body, but as an appeal to God for a good conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God with angels, authorities, and powers made subject to him. The word of the Lord.
He saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit descending like a dove on him. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, the Beloved, with whom you I am well pleased." And the Spirit immediately drove him out into the wilderness. And he was in the wilderness 40 days, tempted by Satan. And he was with the wild beast, and the angels waited on him. Now after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God and saying, "The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Enter this season of a holy Lent. Let the words of that song be our prayer. May you be lifted high in all of our lives, in all of our aspects of lives. As John the Baptist said, Lord, you must increase. And we, and our pettiness, all that must decrease. Help us, at the beginning of this special season, to cast away the impediments that keep us from your very best for us. Help us to be quick to repent, slow to anger. Transform us, Lord, as we lift you high in our lives, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I'd like to invite our children to come. I'd like to welcome the North Carolina McGee family. That's how I refer to my own family. My youngest son lives in New Mexico, so I call them the New Mexican family. Father, in Jesus' name, we ask your blessing upon these boys and girls. We ask that you would just watch over them, protect them. We pray, Lord, that these young people, these folks who were made in your image, that they would always draw near and love you. Yes. And hold you close. Yes. And we pray, Lord, that they would hold you in their hearts all the days of their lives. And we do ask your blessing upon them and their families. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. I know that you are looking at your bulletins and looking at all the announcements. I do want to focus on one especially. It has to do at the bottom of the page on the left. It's Cathedral Texts. If you haven't received any texts on your phone from the church in the last couple of weeks and you want to be on the list, please email Father Mike Wilson at the email address listed with your phone number, and he will be added to the system. If you are not receiving emails from me and you would like to, it's David Epps at ctk.life. And they're on the business card out on one of the tables in the foyer. But I'd just like to keep you apprised at all the things that are happening. I encourage your prayers for the next 3 days. I will be leaving as soon as church is over to go to the airport to pick up Bishop Simpson, who's coming in for the Southeast Archbishops Council in Selma, Alabama. And so we'll be there for a couple of days, and I'll be home late Tuesday evening. So it's always a good time, productive time, spiritual time, actually. And so I covet your prayers for those days and for the travel involved. There is, in our culture, a point of view that is narcissistic, it's autonomous, it's individualistic, it's self-centered, and it's prevalent. And simply put, it's found in the phrase, "It's my body, I'll do what I want." You want to put drugs into your body? It's my body. I'll do what I want. What about the overconsumption of alcohol? Well, it's my body. I'll do what I want. What about promiscuous or illicit sex? It's my body. I'll do what I want. risky behavior for the sake of thrills. It's my body. I'll do what I want. The abortion of a child, it's my body. I'll do what I want. And on we can go. In fact, nothing is to be restrained because, after all, it's my body. I'll do what I want. But is it? In 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 19 and 20, the Apostle Paul writes to a church, and he says to them, to the members of that church, and thus to all the other churches on up to the present day, "Or do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit within you, whom you have from God? You are not your own. For you were bought with a price, so glorify God in your body." You see, if one is a Christian, if one has committed himself or herself to God in Christ, we may occupy this body. It may get us through life, get us to where we're going, but we do not own it. We might say we do, we might think we do, but the scriptures contradict that point of view. It says we do not. It's been purchased. It's been bought. And it's been bought with the blood of Christ on the cross, and the contract was sealed with his resurrection. And not only are Christians not their own, but knowingly or not, since it's clear in Scripture that Jesus gave himself for the whole of humanity, in John 3:16, humanity, even those who are lost and away from God, do not possess ownership of their bodies. That's not to say that everybody's going to be saved, but what it is that Christ sufficient, his sacrifice was sufficient for all who come to him. The price has already been paid for every human being on this planet. Now, for those who insist on a life apart from God, for those who have knowledge of God and insist on a life apart from God, that even though they may be outwardly religious, Jesus says this, as he did to the Pharisees, to the religious leaders of the Jews in his day. This is found in John chapter 8, beginning with verse 44. "You are of your father the devil." Now I'm going to read on. "And you want to do the desires of your father. He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in the truth because there is no truth in him. Whenever he speaks a lie, he speaks from his own nature. He is a liar and the father of lies. But because I speak the truth, you do not believe me." So Jesus is telling even the religious elite, whose hearts are far from God, not turned to God, "You are of your father, the devil." So I guess the question this morning is, who's your daddy? There's a story told in the Cherokee Nation. It's been repeated often, but I came across it this week. And here's the story. A young Cherokee boy came to his grandfather, filled with anger at another boy who had done him an injustice. The old grandfather said to his grandson, "Let me tell you a story. I too at times have felt a great hate for those that have taken so much with no sorrow for what they do. But hate wears you down, and hate does not hurt your enemy. Hate is like taking poison and wishing your enemy would die. I've struggled with these feelings many times. It's as if there are two wolves inside of me. One wolf is good and does no harm. He lives in harmony with all around him and does not take offense when no offense was intended. He will only fight when it is right to do so and in the right way. But the other wolf is full of anger. The littlest thing will set him into a fit of temper. He fights everyone all the time for no reason. He cannot think because his anger and his hate are so great. It is helpless anger. because his anger will change nothing. Sometimes it is hard to live with these two wolves inside me because both of these wolves try to dominate my spirit. The boy looked intently into the grandfather's eyes and asked, "Which wolf will win, grandfather?" The grandfather smiled at his grandson and said, "The one I feed." The story is appropriate and has application here, because if we insist that we have sole and private ownership of our body, that we can do what we want, that no one can tell us otherwise. It's our body. We can do what we want, whenever we want, without regard for God's claim on our lives. Then we feed that dark side of our nature that was first manifest in Satan in heaven when he said, "I will ascend above the Most High. I will." See, that's the sin of the universe. The sin of the universe was not found first in the Garden of Eden. It was found before all of that, when for whatever reason, Lucifer, the worship leader, some say, of the angel choirs, began to think highly of himself and said, "I will ascend." And from that sin, all other sins come. And really, when you look at what happened in the garden, in the creation story with Adam and Eve, it's the same thing. Eve looked upon the fruit as though with desire for it. And ultimately she and Adam too said, I will eat that fruit. I will disregard what God said. And see, that's what it means to me to where we have the choice between God's will and our will. And it's always a choice, isn't it? I will or God will. And that's the prevailing thought in our culture today, often manifested by claiming ownership of our bodies. It's my body. I will do what I want. I will. Not realizing that it is the original sin from which all other sins have spawned. Then there's a contrast that we find in Matthew 26, but I want to read from a different text. And I want to read something that you have heard here almost every Sunday for over 27 years. And you'll hear it today. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, the Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, it's a prayer, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." I don't know how many churches there are in the world today. I don't know of those churches how many are going to celebrate around his table today. But of all the churches throughout all the nations, of all the peoples, of all the races, of everyone who comes to the table, who comes to an altar, whether it's in a cathedral or in a jungle under a United Nations tent or in a desert area under a tree, they're going to hear these or similar words. They're going to hear this. Not only are they going to hear this today, they're going to hear this tomorrow, next Sunday and the next Sunday, and maybe in between Sundays. And the people of God have heard this, said throughout the history, in every empire, in every nation, in every hovel, in every little bitty gathering in catacombs or hiding in a room undergoing persecution. These words have even been said in gulags and in prisons as prisoners get together and surreptitiously somehow in some way scrape together a little bit of bread and something to drink, whether it's probably not wine, but maybe it's water, and that'll have to do. And they've heard these words. This is my body, broken for you, given for you. This is my blood poured out for you. And sometimes it just goes in one ear, I know it does, and it goes out the other. And we become used to it and it becomes right and ritual. But it's not. Of all of those who ever walked the earth, who had a right to say, this is my body, I'll do what I want. Of all of those, and only one who was tempted in every way as we are and yet without sin, only one. Only one, according to Philippians chapter 2 and verses 7 and 8, only one gave up the glories and the privileges of heaven to take on this human form, to submit even to death on a cross, to pay for your sin and mine and for the sin of the world. And that's what he did with his body. He gave it up. This is my body, and it's broken for you. The Apostle John writes in 1 John chapter 2, verse 6, he who says he abides in him ought himself also to walk just as he walked, giving up our bodies to the will of God, as Jesus did. In the summer of 1976, I attended a summer session at Candler School of Theology at Emory University. I took four courses. Well, five if you count the one that we had to take, which was how to pronounce names out of the Old Testament. I'll tell you, that was a thrilling course, I wanted you to know. But there was a professor of theology, and at some point in that course, he took us outside. We found this place on the Emory campus, and there was a table set up, and he gave a message on the body of Christ. I don't remember anything he said, but I do remember what he did. And he had a small loaf, or he had bread. And when he got to these words, and he did it as a part of his teaching, he broke it. And then he did what we do here, but he did it by walking among the students who were sitting on the grass. He walked among us and he goes, this is the body of Christ, broken for you, Tony. This is the body of Christ, broken for you. And so it was until everyone had been served. And then when he got finished, he said, and I want you to notice that there was enough for all with plenty left over. But then he said, but here's the deal. You now, as believers, you bear the image of Christ. You are the representatives, the ambassadors of Christ on the earth. There are none other. There's no one except his people. And so here's the challenge for you. As you receive this bread, And as you receive this wine, as you receive into yourself the body and the blood of Christ, allow yourself to be Jesus. And allow yourself to be given up and broken and passed around. He said, because that's what Jesus did. And he said, and we've been passing him from one person to the next for 2,000 years. Throughout all human history, since he came, and throughout all the nations of the earth. And so when you go back to your hometowns and to your home churches, the next time you walk in that church, remember that you are not your own, that you were bought with a price. And you are to imitate Christ, who gave himself up, and so shall you. And he said, don't worry that there won't be enough left over to be you. So because Jesus has given himself for hundreds of millions, perhaps billions of people, and he hasn't been diminished one bit. And neither shall you. You know, a sermon is often like a meal. You don't remember most of the meals you've ever had, and you don't remember most of the sermons you've ever heard. And I don't remember most of the sermons I've ever preached. But what you do remember about a meal and a message, you remember the truly awful, and you remember the truly impactful for you. And that was impactful for me. How many years ago? 1976 till now, it's a long time. I'll never forget sitting there and hearing this lesson. I've not always lived up to that lesson, but I've never forgotten it. And in essence, it says to me, whose body is it? It's not your body. It's not my body. It's his. And it belongs to him. And it's been designed for holy purposes and holy transformation. Let's allow him to do it. Let's allow him to do it. And let it begin in this season of Holy Lent. Amen. Please stand.
Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and we believe in one God, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten not by all creatures, thy light, that very God, not made, being of righteous with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Virgin Mary. Suffering was buried, and on the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. And he shall come again with glory to judge the living and the dead. His kingdom shall have no end. We believe in one Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father, and with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and we look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Catholic Church,
that we all may be one.
Grant that every member of the church may truly and humbly serve you.
That your name may be glorified by all people.
We pray for our bishops, priests, and deacons,
that they may be ministers of your word.
We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world, give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake,
that our works may find favor in your sight.
Have compassion on the poor, the sick, the hungry, the oppressed, the prisoners, and all who suffer from any grief or trouble,
that they may be delivered from their distress.
Give to the departed eternal rest,
that light perpetual shine upon them.
We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy.
May we also come to share in your heavenly kingdom.
Let us pray for our own needs and those of others.
Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Would you please share the peace of God with those around you? Come and experience the one who said, this is my body, this is my blood, afresh and anew. If you do not know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, I encourage you when you come forward to just pray and repent of your sins and ask him to come into your heart and life. And he will do what he said. If we call upon his name, he will extend his salvation. He's already paid the price. And so let us prepare our hearts as the table is prepared for us.
Thank you.
I appeal to you, brethren, by the mercies of God, to present yourselves as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness you have received the bread we offer you, fruit of the earth and work of human hands. It will become the body of Christ.
Blessed be God forever.
By the mystery of this water and wine, may we come to share in the divinity of Christ, who humbled himself to share in our humanity. Blessed are you, Lord, of all creation, for through your goodness we receive the wine we offer you, fruit of the vine and the work of human hands. It will become the blood of Christ.
Blessed be God forever.
Blessed are you, Lord of all creation. Through your goodness, we bring these tithes and offerings before you. They will be used in your church for the work you have set before us and the furthering of your kingdom. Brethren, pray, brethren, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept this sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and for the good of all his church.
Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For by your gracious gift each year, your faithful await the sacred Paschal feast, and with the joy of minds made pure, so that more eagerly intent on prayer and on the works of charity and in participating in the mysteries by which they have been reborn, they may be led to the fullness of grace that you bestow on your sons and daughters. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim.
Thank you.
Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Let us proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ is risen.
Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, and holy food and drink of your new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity and constancy and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world.
Have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world.
Grant us peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord,
I am not worthy to enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. The gifts of God for the people of God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, Savior Jesus Christ. And you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart through Christ our Lord. Amen. And now the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and abide with you always. Amen.